The 82nd House District includes the city of Petersburg, Dinwiddie County, Prince George County, and Surrey County. And I am homegrown. I'm born and raised in Hopewell, right up the road from the district. I'm the daughter of a union worker. My daddy was a union worker, and my mother was actually my elementary school crossing guard. Personally, I am a single mother. I'm a first-generation college student, and I've been an accountant and an auditor for almost 20 years. I've made my career counting dollars and cents, rooting out fraud, waste, and abuse, no matter who's in office. And now I'm ready to go to Richmond to do some real auditing on behalf of the taxpayers. So let me be clear, there is so much at stake right now in this election. With the razor-thin majorities in the House and the Senate, the balance of the legislature could come down to just one seat. And if it does, it's possible that seat could be the one Republicans flipped in 2021. That was this seat. And I want to be clear about what that means. Republicans' ability to criminalize abortion in the last remaining Southern state without a ban could come down to this race. So my campaign is making sure that voters in the 82nd district know if Republicans take control of our government, my opponent could be the deciding vote in favor of a total 100% ban on abortion. My opponent, Kim Taylor, she wants to put doctors and the women who get abortions, the doctors who provide it and the women who get it in jail, in prison. And that's not hyperbole. This is actually how she's voted. Time and time again, Kim Taylor has sided with the extremists against her own constituents. And that's constituents like me. And now Republicans are only a few votes away from being able to institute a complete and total ban on abortions, including in cases of rape, incest, and when the pregnancy threatens the life of the mother. And I have to tell you, that issue is personal to me. 16 years ago, my husband and I were trying to start a family. And when my home pregnancy test read positive, we were ecstatic. But later when I visited my OBGYN, he couldn't find a heartbeat. I had a miscarriage. And when I miscarried, I felt less than. I felt like something was wrong with me. And so often we tend to focus on the joyous aspects of childbirth, but it's really time we talk about the fact that almost a quarter of pregnancies result in an outcome other than a healthy birth. I mean, I planned my pregnancy and I wanted it to continue, and I was devastated when it didn't. But in many ways, my miscarriage has actually deeply affected the way I feel about the abortion debate today, because all of our reproductive health stories are different. No two of them are the same. I mean, both miscarriages and unplanned pregnancies occur unexpectedly, and they both come with profound personal decisions. But neither of them should have government involvement, and both of them need to be between a woman and her doctor. My miscarriage taught me a valuable lesson that you never think it's going to be you until it is you, or it's someone that you love. We think about politics based on how it affects us. So if I don't need an abortion, then I shouldn't care, right? We should all care. We should all care because this is a challenge to freedom. And as I'm knocking on doors across my district, this is top of mind for voters. Because for us, it's not just about abortion. Any attack on our freedoms, it's just the start. Because extremist Republicans, they may be coming after reproductive freedom now, but they won't stop there. And there are so many other freedoms we have to defend. I mean, they're coming after our freedom to vote, limiting access to the ballot box across the Commonwealth, trying to stop our voices from being heard. They're coming after our freedom to go to work and school in a place that we feel safe. and they're attacking that by preventing any gun violence prevention. I mean, our communities are living in fear, and Republican extremists won't budge one single inch. They're coming after our freedom of speech, banning books across the country because they don't agree with them. Freedom of speech is the bedrock on which our country was built, fostering a society that thrives on the principles of open dialogue, diverse perspectives, and the pursuit of truth. And enough is enough. We need a politics of empathy where we fiercely defend each other's rights. Now, in my case, my next pregnancy after my miscarriage gave me a son. He's 15 years old now, and I've raised him as a single mother for a little over 10 years. And I'm always thinking about the world that I'm going to leave him. And I really hope that his generation has more freedoms than ever before. But if Republican extremists have their way, they'll ban abortions entirely. And women in Virginia will be less safe and less free. I wish I had a say in the outcome of my pregnancy, because if I had, I would have chosen a healthy child. But my miscarriage took away that choice. And when I'm elected, I won't allow politicians to take away yours. So with that said, it is now my honor to introduce the next speaker and the next delegate from the 97th House District, Mr. Michael Fagans.
Hey, Kim, thank you so much for that. I'm looking forward, of course, to being future colleagues with you. Hi, everyone. I'm Michael Fagans. I'm the Democratic nominee for House District 97 here in Virginia Beach. House District 97 is entirely within Virginia Beach. It runs from the most western part of Virginia Beach all the way up to Oceana Naval Air Station. I'm the product of Virginia Beach Public Schools. After living here, I enlisted in the Air Force directly after graduating from Tallwood High School, and then went on to serve for the next 20 years. During that time in the Air Force, I had an incredible career serving everywhere from Langley Air Force Base in Virginia to Anderson Air Force Base in Guam, doing deployments in Operation Enduring Freedom, supporting operations in Afghanistan while stationed in Kyrgyzstan. And after 20 years of an incredible career, I knew it was time for me to come back home and come back home to Virginia Beach to continue my second service. And my second service really connects to my family. My mother is a retired public school teacher here in the neighboring city of Norfolk, and my father is a retired firefighter in Norfolk. But I also followed in his footsteps, in my grandfather's footsteps, in serving in the military. So I come from a family of public servants, and also in terms of service to our nation. And some of the same freedoms that I vowed to protect are now on the line here in Virginia and across the country. The extremists, especially the one that I'm running against, they're attacking healthcare. They're giving tax breaks to large corporations instead of making sure that we're fully funding our public schools. And they're operating lockstep in with the extremist Republicans in Washington, D.C. I've been on the doors here in Virginia Beach running for House District 97 for over 17 months. And one of the major issues I've been hearing time and time again, no matter who I've been talking to, has really been about reproductive freedom. And I want to be crystal clear that if Republicans are able to flip the Senate and keep the House this year, they will institute a ban, and patients will lose their reproductive freedom here in Virginia, and it will be just like how so many other states are in the South. That's why this race is so critical, because Virginia is really the last state in the South that has true reproductive freedom. My opponent wants to make sure to take away those freedoms from patients. And those patients also include the thousands of service members here in Virginia that are stationed here. So those same individuals who are fighting for your rights and are serving our country would then have to travel hundreds or potentially thousands of miles up north to receive the care that they should be able to receive right here in Virginia. When we're looking at some of the more other important issues here in Virginia Beach, it's going to be with education. Like I said, I'm a product of Virginia Beach public school systems. I know that people move here and stay here because of our great public school systems. Our teachers and our administrators are incredible. They work hand in hand with the community, with parents. But unfortunately, my opponent has been focusing more on giving tax breaks to corporations instead of focusing on making sure we can recruit and retain the next generation of educators here in Virginia. When I'm elected, I'm going to make sure that we're working to fully fund our schools and fully fund our teacher pay to make sure we can recruit and retain the best and brightest that we have here in Virginia in our public schools. When we're looking also in terms of one of the other big issues here, especially here in Hampton Roads, as time is ticking by, and we're getting updates by the minute about what's happening in Virginia, in Washington, D.C., we're seeing what's going to be happening with the government shutdown. The government shutdown is going to have a drastic effect here in Virginia, in Northern Virginia, in Richmond, and especially here in Hampton Roads in Virginia Beach. The same extremists that are trying to flip the Senate and take the House of Delegates, flip the Senate, keep the House of Delegates, are the same type of extremists that are in Washington D.C. that are hurting individuals, that are going to be hurting federal employees, but not just federal employees and the federal contracts that we depend on here in Virginia. It's going to hurt my neighbors here in Virginia Beach. It really is. Service members are going to have to work without pay if there's a government shutdown. That is not fear-mongering. That is the statement that has came from the Department of Defense. It's going to hurt my neighbors here at Naval Air Station Oceana, at Little Creek, and so many of the other military installations around here in Hampton Roads. But I can also speak from a direct experience about what that type of government shutdown has. And I speak from experience because during my 20 years, I experienced a few government shutdowns. And the one that I can recall vividly is the one that happened in 2013. When the government shut down in 2013, we were still having, service members still went to work. We still did our job. But every day, when we were taking breaks or in between our getting ready to teach our classes, I was an instructor at the time at the School of Aerospace Medicine, teaching medical professionals how to deploy all around the world to take care of patients. During our breaks, it was heavy on our mind that we're working for free right now, that we're defending our country, that we're giving everything that we can to the mission that we love, to the service. No matter what branch of service you were working in, but it was getting close to the point to where, as the government shutdown kept going on, that we were thinking about that we were going to have to go without pay on that October 15th, and maybe extend it further down the line. And so maybe some of the extreme Republicans in D.C. don't fully understand, but it's going to have devastating effects on our enlisted especially. Our enlisted service members are the backbone of the military. And while some of our higher ranking officers and higher senior NCOs will be able to deal with maybe receiving a paycheck or two, those junior enlisted, those frontline non-commissioned officers, they are going to be the ones who have to deal with this. And while trying to take care of their families, trying to imagine having to take care of your family, take care of the mission, and understand that you might not get this paycheck that you are owed until later down the line. And so that is what we're seeing here. I cannot overestimate the damage that this government shutdown will do to our service members in terms of it weighing on their minds, and then not just weighing on their minds, but just the ramifications that it's going to have on their families. And so as we've been focused on this race, we know that the pathway, the flipping the House of Delegates, runs through a lot of the seats here, especially here on this call. But it ends here on House District 97. And so we know when we flip House District 97, that means we will know that we have taken back the House of Delegates. And, you know, and I want to make sure that everybody understands that I am super optimistic about the future of Virginia Beach and the future of the Commonwealth. But it's only going to happen if we can get our voters out, we will win. We know that if we can mobilize our voters, we will flip the House of Delegates and we will keep the Senate. We will make sure that reproductive freedom is here. We'll make sure that we're fully funding our educators, fully funding our school systems. And that's why I launched my campaign 17 months ago. And, you know, with 39 days left into the election, we feel great about the chances. And we know on November 7th, when the polls close and the final votes are counted, that we have taken back the House of Delegates and we have a brighter future for Virginia. So with that, I want to pass it on to what I will hope to be my future colleague, Delegate Rodney Willett.
Hey, Michael, thank you so much. I'm Rodney Willett, and for the past 4 years, I've had the honor of serving in the Virginia General Assembly representing Western Henrico. That's the part of Western Henrico that comes to the west of the city of Richmond. Kim and Michael could not be more correct. There's so much at stake in this election. But what we're seeing are MAGA extremist opponents. They're not just attacking Virginia women and medical freedoms or weakening our public school system and depriving our children of the quality education they deserve. They want to make the Commonwealth a drastically less safe place to live and raise a family by repealing our current gun safety laws and also defeating all new gun safety measures. One of the highlights of my 2021 campaign was hosting a visit by Congresswoman and gun violence survivor Gabby Giffords. At that time, we were celebrating our passage of 8 gun measures from 2020 to 2021. That's when we had a Democratic majority in the Virginia House, the Senate, and then also a Democratic governor, Ralph Northam. So there I was yesterday, standing with the Congresswoman again, but not so proud this time. Actually, I was incredibly frustrated by the fact that Republicans in the majority in the House since 21 have blocked us from being able to pass any other laws to try to save people from gun violence in Virginia. The laws that we passed while we're in the majority did a number of things. They kept guns out of the hands of domestic abusers and violent criminals. In fact, after I was elected in 2019, one of the first pieces of legislation that I voted on was Virginia's red flag law. We've seen that law save countless lives and stop mass shootings. It's been associated with a decrease in firearm suicides. It's just a common sense measure. But Virginia Republicans in the House this session voted to repeal that law. And you can bet they'll try that again if they take back the House and hold on to the Senate in November. But it's not just the red flag law that's under attack. They're trying to make it easier to carry guns in public. They're blocking our municipalities from implementing common sense gun measures that's at the local level. They've impeded passing laws that would keep guns away from children, shorten the waiting time for an individual to purchase a firearm. Just as a point of reference, the terrible Walmart shooting here in Virginia, the Walmart shooter purchased his gun the day of the shooting. That just shouldn't happen. I knock hundreds of doors every week. I talk to hundreds of voters. Parents are scared. They're scared about their kids going to school and not coming home from school because of gun violence. How wrong is that? How wrong is that for parents to not feel safe sending their kids to school? I mean, here in Henrico, we've had to implement scanners for kids coming into the schools to see if their weapons. Weapons have been found in Henrico high schools, middle schools, and even elementary schools. And again, that's just not right, but it speaks to the problem we're dealing with. And look, you know, my family and I are gun owners. Actually, all three of us on this call today are all three of us speaking to you today are gun owners. And so, hey, no problem with the right to have guns and doing so in a responsible way. You know, I talk to my family members and other, you know, gun owner friends of mine. There's no issue with the kind of laws we're talking about here. We're not talking about taking away guns. We're just talking about reasonable, common sense measures. And probably the most one of the most important of those is safe storage. We had a safe storage bill proposed in the House this past session. Now, this is directed at keeping guns away from children. And I can tell you, it's just a common sense, you know, low-hanging fruit kind of bill. And Republicans killed that bill in the House. It's just unbelievable to me. I have looked in the eyes of parents of children who died by gun violence. It's the number one source of more kids die from guns than any other cause in the country, and that's true in Virginia. But I've looked those parents in the eye and told them that if I get reelected, I'm going to carry that safe storage bill and really dare the Republicans to oppose it, because we've got to get this to the finish line. It's just common sense. But again, this is just an example of the things that are on the line we've been talking about today. If we don't take the House back, that's why I'm working nonstop between here now and November 7th. Let my neighbors know what's at stake. I've lived here my whole life and raised three kids here. I want this to be a safe place for my family, but certainly all Virginians. And that's the kind of thing that's at stake with this election. So I'm going to keep at it all the way to election day. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Heather, and all three of our candidates. We'll now open this up for a question and answer session.